Come on up here and testify. Come on, man. You can be seated. This is our children's evangelist, the King's Clown, the one and only Reverend Lloyd Squires. We love you so much. We're so glad you're here. Amen. There he goes over there. Right there, third row.
God bless you. Love you. See you soon.
What? All right. We love you, Brother Squires. Let's tell Brother Squires we love him, everybody. Come on, Pentecostals. Welcome, Brother Squires, our children's advantages. Amen. Well, we want to give you an opportunity to worship the Lord in your giving. Our ushers are coming at this time. Giving envelopes, contribution envelopes, will be located right here in the center of the platform, and then the basket's on the right-hand side, left-hand side. If you need an envelope, feel free to come and get one while I'm making these announcements. Amen. You're perfectly fine. I know it seems awkward. Just walk right down here, get you an envelope, and you're good to go. All right, so announcements, of course, our services this morning while we're having evangelist Greg Albritton and his family here. Amen. Brother Rivera was preaching next door, missionary to Puerto Rico. Is that right? Is he over there? Yeah, missionary to Puerto Rico's over there. And, of course, here's his kids right here. Amen. We love you, Abigail. We're glad you guys are here. All right, and then tonight, Brother Albritton will be back with us in our 6 p.m. service. Also, Brother Squires will be in our kids' church for 6 p.m. service tonight. You don't want to miss that. And then next Sunday, we have evangelist Victor Jackson with us in all 3 services, and that's going to be exciting as well. Amen. Our midweek service schedule remains as it was last week, so we have our midweek Wednesday night at 6 o'clock for at-risk and those who are the elderly or those that feel like they might be at risk, and then 7:30 p.m. for everyone else. Amen. I think that's all of the announcements. Now, Pentecostals, will you help me this morning welcome our guests? All right. All right, I'm going to hold you to it. Now, if you're a first or second time guest here with us, you should have received a guest card on the way in the auditorium, and that's has some free gifts associated with it. We want you to have them. So if it's your first time or your second time and you didn't receive a card on the way in the auditorium, lift your hand and the ushers will get that to you right now. First or second time guests and you didn't receive a card on the way in. All right, looks like we have everybody covered. Hey, when I read your name or when I say your name or something that sounds like your name, just lift your hand so we can see where you're seated. We don't want to embarrass you, but we do want to acknowledge you with us this morning. First-time guests, Haley, Ella, and I think it says Joycelyn Church. Where are you folks at this morning? Over here on the left. God bless you. We're so glad you're here this morning. Amen. Also, first-time guests, Henry Cordova and Marisol Caballero. Right here in the center section. God bless you. We're so glad you're here. All right. Second-time guest, Caitlin Berry. Caitlin, where are you at this morning? Wave your hand at me. Over here on the right. God bless you. We're glad you're here this morning. All right. Second-time guest, William Kaiser. Where art thou, sir? Lift your hand. Looking. Where? Ah, right there in the back. God bless you. We're glad you're here. All right. And, of course, I've already mentioned our evangelist, Greg Albritton, and his children right here in the third row. Let's welcome Brother Albritton. God bless you. We're so glad you're here. Amen. So, we're going to do 2 things at one time. I know you can handle it. Let's all stand together. Amen. So, what I want you to do, since we're still not shaking hands, is turn around and wave at all of the people in your section across the aisle. Turn around, wave at them, smile at them, tell them you love them, you're glad to see them. All right, this basically consists of our meet and greet for the next several weeks. Amen. Now, if you have your offering, let's lift that toward the Lord right now. Lord Jesus, we're so thankful for this chance, this opportunity to be in your house, to be with your people. We ask you to bless this offering, both the gift and the giver, in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. Amen.
Yeah. generation to my past and erase it and make me a brand new creature. No. He took a chance on a wretched sinner like you. Hallelujah. Oh, the doctors don't have the answer. The CDC can't fix it. But Jesus is still the answer. I said, Jesus is still the answer. Nobody else but Jesus. My hope is not in this world. I said, it's not in this world. One of these old mornings, it won't be very long. You're gonna be watching CNN, but I'll be going home. Can't nobody do me like the Lord.
Can't nobody do me like Jesus.
Can't nobody do me like Jesus.
Can't nobody do me like Jesus.
I've been putting all my hope in the Lord.
Can't nobody do me like Jesus.
Going up to heaven.
Swimming pool. Some of you are like sticking your toes in. I'd love to come along and just push you on in the water. Amen. It feels good in this place this morning. God is good. I said, God is good. Amen. I can't help but think while we're singing that, just my mind goes back to a few years ago. I would go visit a lady. She was 92 years old. She couldn't hear. We would yell at one another, and she'd say, huh, and I'd yell it again, and whatever it is I was saying, we'd yell two or three times, and half the time she would figure it out, and half the time she would just go on talking about something, and we would laugh. And one day I went to see her, and she said, oh, Brother Wilson, she said, I got to tell you what happened last night. And she started telling the story. She said, I've been down a little bit. She said, I haven't been feeling good, and I haven't been able to go to church. And she was struggling with some health issues, 92 years old, still living on her own, next little house next to her daughter and son-in-law. She said, last night, she said, I was awake. She's about 3 o'clock in the morning. And she said, I couldn't go back to sleep. She said, I got up out of my bed, and she said, I started to walk around that bed, and all of a sudden, I started thinking about the goodness of Jesus. She said, I stopped at 3 o'clock in the morning. I grabbed that bedpost, and she said, 92 years old, she said, I started dancing. She said, I didn't get my feet up high. She said, but I was moving my feet. She's telling me the story, and all of a sudden, she goes speaking in tongues, and she finally gets back to talking English. She said, oh, my goodness. She said, it felt so good. Amen. So I want to challenge you here this morning. I don't know what you've been going through. I don't know what all's been going on in your mind, all the pressure, all the stress, all the anxiety, but I promise you, if you put your hands together, put your lips together, begin to magnify the name of the Lord, and perhaps begin to move your feet a little bit and begin to worship the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay, here's the problem. Here's the problem with some of us, and I'm not the preacher, but I'm just going to say this real quick, and I'm going to get out of the way. Here's the problem with some of us, is that it's hard for us to worship, praise, give God thanksgiving, because we are so consumed with our trouble. But I like what the old writer said, when I think of the goodness of Jesus, and all he has done for me. I know it may not be perfect, but he's done a lot for me. I may not have everything that I want, but he's done a lot for me. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, my soul cries out. Hallelujah. I wonder in this house, just for the next 20 seconds or so, would you put your hands together, lift up your voice, and just shout hallelujah. Shout out to the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Remain standing. The preteen, your class is dismissed right now for preteen class. We are so thrilled to have our evangelist with us today, Reverend Greg Albritton. Pastor will be here in a moment. He is greeting the Spanish congregation right now. But there he is. He's not greeting the Spanish congregation right now. Here he comes.
All right. Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. We had a little bit of church there for a few minutes in Spanish ministry. Amen. So thank God for what he's doing. I've been hearing the sounds of worship from over here as well. So thank God for what he's doing today. And it's good to see everybody in the house of the Lord. So good to see my mom and my sister back in the back. Mom, wave at everybody. This is the original Sister McKee. And that's the original recipe right back there. So amen. But it's so good to have her here with us. And yes, we are excited about the ministry of Brother Greg Albritton here with us today. And he's been a long, long time friend of our family. And it's just so good to have him here preaching the word of the Lord. He is a full-time evangelist with the United Pentecostal Church, doing a great work, and based out of Alexandria, Louisiana. And we're thrilled to have him. How many is going to help the preacher preach this morning? Amen. Praise God. Before I introduce him, I want to say this one thing. We are continuing with our Sunday 8 a.m. service, okay? For those that are watching, our broadcast, the earlier service is not streamed, so for those that are watching, I want to encourage you, if you are high risk or, you know, underlying conditions, whatever, Sunday morning is a great place to be here. 8 a.m. is a great service to attend if you're concerned about social distancing and all of that. Come Sunday morning, 8 a.m. There's plenty of room, and it's a growing service every week, so thank God for what he's doing. And we invite you to be back. We have no intention of quitting the 8 a.m. service, by the way. I've wanted to have one of these for a long time, so this whole quarantine thing just gave us a good excuse to start one. So, amen. I'm excited about that. It's continuing to grow, and some may question, well, why would he have it after the quarantine and all that's over with? The reason is we have many of our saints that work on Sunday, and they have to be in at work at 8 or 10 a.m., and so that gives them the opportunity to come in early, be in service with us, and then go on to work. So, amen. It's a great opportunity for us to reach into a sort of a brand new area of ministry. Amen. It is so good to have Brother Greg Albritton here with us. Why don't you put your hands together? Let's welcome Brother Greg Albritton as he comes to ministry.
Thank you, Pastor, and praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. Let's lift it up another notch. Praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. It's so good to be in God's house. Hallelujah. To feel his presence, to be among his people. Hallelujah. Amen. I give you honor today. It's so great to be with you all, the Pentecostals of Katy. And this is our first ministry weekend back traveling. And so since March the 15th, now don't that doesn't mean that we haven't ministered. I kind of got spoiled to being able to record a message on Friday night and watch myself preach on Sunday in my Under Armour without having combed my hair and just kick back on the couch and being at church and different churches. That kind of spoiled me. But I can't lie, I am so happy. We were able to be at church, at our home church at POA last Sunday, and that was special. Just getting back together with God's people and then to be here today with you all. Amen. Such an honor and a highlight, and we are so, so excited. And God's going to minister today. I just sense it. I feel it. I peeked in on last Sunday's service, and Brother Dross is just so powerful. And then I just hear that Brother Victor Jackson is coming next Sunday. No pressure on the man in the middle. And then I thought, well, you know, if we're a sandwich, the meat's usually in the middle. Don't tell my friends that. Don't tell my friends that. Amen. Powerful, powerful men of God. And I'm honored to be a part of, to be a part of that. Praise the Lord. My children are with me today, Emery, Eden, and Creed. And kind of a special day for Emery and I when Brother Squires walked in, because he was preaching years ago in Denver when she got the Holy Ghost. And that's very special. And then had a first yesterday. She's 16. And has her driver's permit, and she drove from the house to the hotel, and Daddy got to sit in the passenger seat, and I kind of liked that. I prayed through once or twice, but besides that, we had a great, great trip, and she knows every law that was shared in that driver's ed class, and if she's ever a policeman, a lot of people are going to be getting tickets. That's all I can say. Praise God. Such an honor to be with our friends, Brother and Sister McKee. We love you all, and thank you for loving my family. Amen. Thank you for your ministry to us. And I want to give honor to them in just a moment. Let me say this. I just want to pause. I do this in every pulpit I've been in this last year. Thank you for loving and supporting and praying for my family during this last year or two of journey that we've been on. We literally, this is not imagery, this is literally, we feel that we are being carried by the prayers of God's people. And when I go to churches where I may know your face, or I may not, ministering in a different church every weekend, and I may not know your name, but precious folks walk up to me with tears brimming in the corner of their eyes and say, we call your names out every week. We've prayed for you. We've stood with your family. Thank you, thank you, thank you. We love you all, and we feel and sense that support. And I just want to take a moment, Sister McKee, on my prayer list. I have it. It's called Prayer List 1. That's one of my playlists. Song number 1 is That's What Jesus Does. One day last week, I was in a tough spot, and I hit it on repeat for about 6 times. Thank you for allowing the Lord to use you to write that song. It's ahead of Revelation song, and it's ahead of He's in the Waiting. It's ministered me over and over. And then Pastor, many times driving home from a revival, I'll put my headphones in and listen to the radio app and get some good preaching and singing in. And you preached a message a while back, and I had to make sure I had the title right from Pastor. But it's called Songs for Trouble, or Songs in a Time of Trouble. And I wept riding down the highway. You ministered to me, and I thank you all and love and appreciate you all so much. And Brother and Sister Wilson, been long time friends. Go way, way back, and I give honor to them today. And just God's working in their lives is so beautiful and so powerful, and it's such an honor to be with my friends today. Amen. And we've shared together and become very close over this last year, and you've been a strength to me, and I thank you for that so much. And give honor to the mayors and the ministry staff and to all of you, and just a privilege to be with you tonight. Let's look in the Word today. Let's look in the Word of the Lord in John chapter 5. John chapter 5. I'm going to have a little bone to pick with Brother Squires after the service, so that's the least amount of words I've ever heard him say when given a microphone. I think one of my favorites is when they asked him to say something one time, and he just went and pointed at a speaker. And he stood there and giggled and did the things he did, and he said, "I want you to meet our guest speaker." Praying that kids will get the Holy Ghost next door. And if you need the Holy Ghost or a miracle or refreshing or renewing, amen. Pastor Wilson has already said this. Step into the pool. Amen. Jump in. Get into what God is doing. John 5, a little bit longer reading than I normally do, but let's read. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting, please notice this term, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Some versions say move the water or stir the stirring of the waters. Whosoever then first, after the troubling or the stirring of the water, whoever stepped in first was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. The Bible doesn't go into the background of how and why and the details of this happening. It just mentions that when the waters were stirring, whoever, and I've thought of this, and maybe one of the ministers can give me more insight, but here are paralyzed, crippled, hurting people, but when the waters are stirred, they have to do, you talk about effort, whatever it takes to try to get in to receive a miracle or a healing. But that's the way it happened. When the waters were stirred, you did everything you could to get in those waters for the opportunity for the supernatural. A certain man was there, had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie, he knew he had been a long time in that case and said unto him, "Will you be made whole?" The impotent man answered, "Sir, I have no man when the waters is troubled or when the waters are stirred to put me into the pool. Someone seems to step in before me." Jesus said, verse 8, "Rise, take up your bed and walk." Immediately the man was made whole, took up his bed and walked. I want to minister today on the subject, when the waters are troubled. When the waters are troubled, you may be seated. Lord, your word is already anointed, but I'm asking you, let a specific anointing come upon your word today. I'm asking that the Spirit would move in this house from the front row to the back, from the left wall to the right. Amen. On the platform, all the way back to those serving in the media ministry. Let your presence move in every single aisle of this church. We lift our hearts to you. We pray the anointing upon the man of God to preach. But Lord, I believe the anointing is just as important that comes upon someone to receive. Let there be anointing flowing in this house. Could we lift our hands right where we sit? Lord, let your anointing flow. Let the ministry of your Spirit flow. Let your power and your presence flow in this room today. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Now, this phrase in our day, "the waters are troubled," has come to represent the stirring of the Spirit. I imagine there are times that pastor or someone leading the service may just say, without even referencing what they're referring to, they may just say, "The waters are troubled tonight." And you and I have the understanding that means, it means good things. It's not bad trouble. That's good trouble. That's a current. That's a flow. That's a stirring in the atmosphere of the Spirit of God. I believe that phrase, "the waters are troubled," has come to represent the stirring of the Spirit, or we may also call it a move of God. When that is happening, when that is unfolding, it becomes vital for us. It becomes of utmost importance for us to do whatever it takes. Whatever it takes when that starts. Now, God's here all the time, but when there is a specific stirring and there is a moving happening like that, if crippled and paralyzed and lame folks would do whatever they could do to get into that pool, then I can do whatever it takes to get into the middle of that atmosphere when God is moving. So when the waters are troubled, then our responsibility is to get into that presence. I want to take us back to Genesis chapter 1. And the Bible begins, very first verse of the Bible, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was, and I want you to notice these three things, and I'm sure those of you that's been through Bible studies in your lifetime, you see how this parallels human life so much. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. That was the condition of the earth. That's the condition of our lives before Jesus. We're formless, we're empty, and darkness was over the earth. And so the Bible then says, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. I want you to notice that with me. The Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And then the next verse says, and God said, let there be light. And over the next several verses, time after time, and God said, let there be, and there was. Let there be, and there was. There were layers of God speaking while the Spirit was moving over the waters. Now, another word for that word moved, the Spirit of God moved upon the waters. It literally means the Spirit of God hovered above the surface of the waters. Now, has anyone ever seen a hovercraft or a helicopter hovering? Has anyone ever seen that or a video of that? It looks graceful. I mean, here's this monstrosity of equipment that's in the air just hanging there. It looks beautiful from a distance. It may even look beautiful up close. But has anyone ever been under a helicopter that's hovering at a close distance? Has anyone ever seen a helicopter hover above water? What looked graceful, if you get close to that, there is a turbulence in the water. The waves are actually whipping up. You're holding your coat and your hair if you're under that on the ground, on land, because the hovering, though it may appear graceful, brings about a stirring. It brings about a turbulence. So what happened at creation is God. I just see the waters whipping up. I see some white caps. I see that it's not just the general God inhabits the entire atmosphere. No, he's headquartered right here at the moment. This is concentrated God power, and he's hovering, and while he's hovering, the waters are stirring. And then while the waters were stirring, God began to speak, and God said, I speak this into existence. I speak this. And the combination of the Spirit hovering and the Word speaking and the Spirit hovering and the Word speaking brought about, We label it one word, creation. I call it layer miracles. I thank God for instant miracles. I've been a part of them, and I preach about them, and I'm excited about them. But most of my miracles in my life have been what I term layer miracles. You look back over 7 days of creation, God did this. God did this, and then you look back and it's one miracle called creation. And most miracles in my life, God works, something shifts, something moves forward. God speaks again. His Spirit hovers again. He speaks again. And I look back and God has done a mighty miracle in my life. And when God was finished, this world was no longer formless, void, or full of darkness, because his speaking, it brought about and it shaped the earth. Let this be separated from this. Waters here, lands here. And by the time he was finished, it was shaped, it was filled, and there was no more darkness. His Spirit hovered and his Word worked. I would imagine there are some sitting in this room today that you came to the Lord through the same or similar process. Sometimes it may be the word working first and then the spirit hovers, or sometimes it's the spirit hovering and then the word works. But I imagine there's many of you, you may have even believed differently, and then you got in a Bible study and a friend started sharing, sitting at a table somewhere, and say, well, man, let's go here and let's go here and let's look here. And you're thinking all this stuff and you're going, I'm wondering what's going on. And then they said, hey, would you like to come to church with me next Sunday? And then you get in church and all of a sudden you feel some white caps start whipping up around you, and your hair's getting kind of messed up, and all of a sudden you realize the word's been talking to you, but now the spirit's hovering over you. You couldn't wait to get to an altar. You couldn't wait to get baptized because you stepped into the water when you felt the spirit hovering you. Anybody be willing to give me a nod or an amen? That's kind of how it worked in your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me just say it like this. God is at his best working in our lives when the hovering spirit and the spoken word and the written word are giving full liberty to operate. And like I said, sometimes that happens in reverse order. I've seen people come and stand under the hovering and get the Holy Ghost and get baptized and don't have a clue what just happened. Then the word's going to work over the next few days and weeks. Others may be in a Bible study for months and, oh, I'm not going to that church. And then you go one time and that's the best thing you ever did. You got into his presence. Let's move to 1 Chronicles chapter 14. 1 Chronicles 14, verse 13 through 16. Now, this story has always intrigued me because, and I don't have time this morning, but if you back up just a few verses, it says the Philistines, they came against David, they came against them, and the Bible says David inquired of the Lord. Then just about three verses later, and David rejoiced over that victory, but three or four verses later, it says, and we join it here today in chapter 14, verse 13. And the Philistines yet again spread themselves in the valley. And the Bible says, David inquired again of God. It's not our message today, but just consider it. For every time the enemy comes again, I have another again of seeking God for direction. I may have defeated him last week, but if he shows up again this week, I'm going to Jesus again this week. As many times as the enemy comes back, I'll have an again for everyone he has. He comes to me, I go to Jesus. That's a pretty easy formula. But I want us to notice something. David, in verse 14, inquired again of God, and God said unto him, go not up after them. Turn away from the Philistines. I mean, David must have wanted to attack right now. Let's go, God. Let's get them. And God said, oh, no, back off for just a moment. Turn away. Change your strategy and come upon them over against the mulberry trees. God, my enemy is setting up camp to attack me. And you're sending me to a KOA. You're sending me to a campground at the edge of a mulberry tree. You want me to go camp out, put up the tents, hang out? The Lord said, just settle down, circle around. He did still say, come up against them. We're just changing our strategy. Go hang out by the mulberry trees. Verse 15, and it shall be when thou shalt hear. Somebody notice this with me. When thou shalt hear a sound of going in the tops of the mulberry trees. And again, I'm seeing a helicopter when it's flown low and hovering or over some trees or bushes. I've seen that before. It's just looks like a small hurricane coming through. I'm having that visual picture right now. When you hear that sound, then you can go out to battle, because you know in that moment, God's everywhere. He was with you yesterday, last week, but when the enemy's coming against your family, and when the enemy's coming against your home, and when the devil's coming against your children, sometimes you just don't barge out the front door taking on hell with a water pistol. Sometimes God's going to say, hold off a day or two or a week. You seek me. You put your trust in me. But when you hear the hovering began to happen, when you sense the moving and the stirring of the Spirit, it's time to act right now. God said, you go at that moment. Because when you hear that going in the tops of the trees, that, then you know it is time. It is time to attack, because God will smite the host. God has gone forth. Folks, and I just felt this morning. It's just a little bit of practical. But I've got so many God stories with cars, God stories with healing, God stories with houses. If I'm looking for a car, I start naming the make and the model and the year. If I'm going to buy one 2 or 3 years old, and just start praying and start looking, and it'll blow your mind when you may have been looking for 3 or 4 weeks or a month and say, well, this ain't working. And all of a sudden, shoo, and you feel the Holy Ghost saying, this your car? I've had it happen with houses. I've told this story several times over the last few weeks. But with a home, a few years ago, our finances were challenged as far as having a big down payment. And then we didn't want to rent. But at that season, it looked like renting a home was going to be the deal. And we were trying to find something to purchase. And it wasn't working. And then a deal fell through while we were on the property of one that we thought, maybe if all this stuff comes together, this can work. And the Lord impressed me in our discouragement leaving that property. He said, I mean, this is weird, but it's just the impression. The Lord just impressed me. Give $500 for the next 3 Mondays to whoever I put on your heart and put your house situation in my hand. First Monday, check to missionary. Second Monday, check to folks in Pennsylvania that do campus ministry full time. Third Monday was Memorial Day, 3 years ago today. The third Monday was Memorial Day, and my precious wife said, the post office is closed today. I know God said Monday, but this one's going to have to be on Tuesday. And we put it in the mail on Tuesday. And on Wednesday, our bank called, said, we know y'all don't want to rent. You want to own. But you really need to look at this one. One of our clients, he owns many properties. And how he bought this one, he can't sell it right now. It's beautifully remodeled. It's 3,000 square feet. It's on an acre. It has live oak trees. And he just called us and wanted to know if we knew a family maybe that could be placed in his home with the option to buy. Later, I went to the church and prayed. God gave me a number, because now the Spirit's hovering. Amen. And the Lord gave me a number, $300 or less a month than what he was asking. I called. I said, hey, sir, this number seems to work for me. I know you're asking this. Are you willing? He said, well, I don't want to, but I will. Y'all know where the key's at. You can start moving stuff in tomorrow. We'll worry about rent next month. God bless you. Amen. When the Spirit starts moving. I don't have the answer how and why it worked out that way, but for several weeks and months, God, it wasn't an easy journey. But when the Spirit moved, all right. So I want to take us back to 2009. We pastored in Colorado, church of about 60 or 70 members at the time, desperately seeking revival, and an elder was connected with us and came to preach for us. And I will just tell you, he stayed 9 weeks, Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. He loved Jesus, but I think he loved fighting the devil just as much as he loved Jesus. I call him just an old warrior. He was an old devil fighter, and he was unorthodox. He didn't do things just the normal way, kind of like Jesus. Like the example would be Jesus with the mud in the eyes. I'm like, Jesus, you could have just laid hands on him. A little unorthodox, but it worked. One Saturday night, he called me and he said, I need 2 wash tubs full of water in front of the pulpit. I need towels for service in the morning. I'm the pastor and I'm thinking wash tubs. It's 8 o'clock on Saturday night. I got to go find some wash tubs. So I went to Walmart. The closest I found with some blue, big plastic-looking wash tubs. I bought them, had water in them, had towels. He said, hand me a stack of towels by each tub. And so I thought, I said, well, Elder, are we doing foot washing tomorrow? He said, no, we're not doing foot washing. He said, you'll see. He said, but this is going to represent the waters being troubled. And people that want something from God, I'm going to ask them to step in these tubs. And I know I'm supposed to be spiritual, I'm the pastor, but the practical side of me said, so guests or friends or people at church, they're going to have to roll up their pants leg, their guy, and take off their socks and shoes. Yeah, and ladies going to have to take off. And then by the 12th person, we're not changing the water. My mind's thinking through all this stuff. I hope people's feet are very clean. But that's the logical side of me. But Jesus saying, go put mud in your eyes and spit in them, that's not real practical either. And so my spirit knew to say, okay, elder. So that next morning, we had two tubs. We had the towels stacked up, and he preached a message, something about the waters being stirred, and you step in when the Lord's moving. And I can't really remember the details of the message, but our text was his text. And at the end of the service, me standing, sitting right over there to the side, and when he said, and the way we're going to do our altar service today is if you want something from God. And when I saw that church line up, and businessmen and leaders taking off their socks and shoes and standing in line and waiting, because people wasn't just jumping in and jumping out. They would stand there and start praying, and it was two at a time. And then what I watched unfold, we had a lady who had been a guest at our church. We had hosted her and her friends in our home, reaching out to them, loving them, and she loved the Lord so much. And her stage name or her name that she used for her basketball team was called Lady Magic. Magic Prophet was her name. She is on the Hall of Fame at the University of Missouri. I think had to set the records for the most three-pointers. She played her professional ball overseas. She was leading a show basketball team called the Harlem Ambassadors. They weren't the Harlem Globetrotters, but similarly in the fact they would go into schools, teach education, stay off of drugs, keep your life clean, get educated, and then they would do a show in that community, and they had dunkers and ball handlers, and they were amazing. And she would bring the whole team to church. Their training camp was right there near our church, and she had the Holy Ghost. She loved the Lord. And when that lady came up to the front and knelt down, and she said, Pastor, I feel the Lord just dealt with me. I'm supposed to dry everyone's feet when they get out of the tub. And I looked down at the other tub, and a friend that had been coming to the church who was a decorated Marine, his dad and his uncle pilots, nationally known televangelists, and just a tremendous guy, decorated in the Marine. He's a martial arts trainer, a sniper, a sharpshooter trainer, and all of that. And he had been coming to church, and he came and knelt at the other tub and said, the Lord dealt with me to dry everyone's feet that steps in. So people would pray and stand there, and they would step out, and guests were there to grab the towel and dry their feet. It was a beautiful, probably lasted about an hour. Everybody knows what that is, right? Lord, help it happen on the inside just like it happens on the outside. So the service was wrapping up. People had been touched. People had been ministered to. People had been just powerfully moved on by God. But you know how it is when it's finally settling down and the service is wrapping up and people start talking and doing their thing. And my wife Jamie looked up front, and our daughter Emery was about 5 years old, 6 years old, 5 years old at the time. She had had an incredible allergies. Her doctor, pediatrician, and then allergy doctor said it was the strongest, youngest that he had ever seen. Normally it set up like at 3 and 4. Hers was like 2.5. Fatal levels of allergic to peanuts and some shellfish and a couple different things. Every restaurant we would go in, Jamie would ask Can I talk to the chef? Do you cook with peanut oil? It was serious business. The service was wrapping up. People were leaving. People were talking. And Sister Jamie looked up, and in one of the tubs was my five-year-old. And she was standing in the water. And Sister Jamie thought that she was playing. And she said, "Emery, those aren't to be played in. This is not playtime." And in the words of a five-year-old, she said, I'm not playing, Mommy. I'm praying for my peanuts." That was the way she worded it as a five-year-old. "I'm praying for my peanuts." And obviously, her mom locked in and began to pray. And several people began to pray. And very shortly afterwards, we took her to the allergy doctor. They couldn't find allergic reaction to peanuts because the waters were troubled. Because the waters were troubled. And with childlike faith. Huh? I'm not playing, Mommy. That was childlike faith. I'm praying for God to heal me. And He did. Huh? Because she stepped in when the moving was happening. She felt that as a child. So that was 2009. Let me fast forward to 2020. February and March, before the stay-at-home orders and before the quarantine and the shutdown, I'm from just across the border, but in Louisiana, we'd say that's a pretty good one going on. Amen. Amen. But in February and March, my travels, mostly in Louisiana, 2 hours, 3 hours, preaching on Sunday, preaching on Wednesday. My Creed man would go with me every trip. My girls, my niece and nephew, a little older, live there in Alexandria, and they connect with them for church, and they would stay home, and they would go to church at home, their home church, to be with their friends and family, and Creed and I would travel. And on these travels, he had began sharing some of the hurts and the challenges that he's walked through as a 7-year-old. And I remember one night on one of those rides, maybe late February, March, I said, "Creed, the Holy Ghost is going to help you. I know we got counseling and help, but the Holy Ghost is going to help you. When you get the Holy Ghost, it's going to help you with some of these things that you're feeling," trying to plant that seed. So March 15th was my last Sunday to minister on a Sunday. March 12th was my last Sunday to minister on a Wednesday. That was March 12th would have been, I may be messing the dates up, but the Wednesday prior to March 15th. Now on that Friday night, we had a special night planned. See, when I was a child, we didn't go to sporting events, a lot of different things that we did not, you know, just go do all this stuff. But my dad took me to see the Harlem Globetrotters. And it was a special trip and a special event. And so they were coming to Alexandria, and I was going to take my Creed man. And so somebody had given us a love offering, so I got the good tickets, and we were going to get to meet them before the game, and it was cool. And we had had a paper chain, 14 links in the chain, and had counted down, tearing off a link in that chain. And on Thursday, they were coming on Friday. We had one link in the chain left, and I got the email that said, "Event postponed due to the shutdown." So I knew this is getting really real. And when I explained this one to him, it's really going to be real. And so gathered the family in on that Thursday night. But for the first time in years, on that Wednesday night service, I shared with them the story of the water tubs and Emery stepping in the water tubs and being healed from her allergies to peanuts. That was on Wednesday. Thursday, the event was shut down, and we're having a family meeting in the bedroom. And I'm leading up to telling him, the event's canceled, and this is happening. I talked about what Pastor had said and what the president had said, and we were working through it. But on the way home from that Wednesday night, My creed man told me, he said, Daddy, I think that's my favorite preaching that you've ever done. I love that story about the wash tubs. So on Thursday night, I'm talking, trying to be sensitive, sharing what's happened. And towards the end of my talking, and I told him I was going to share this today, but towards the end of my talking, spirit of hurt and fear came on my child. And we prayed together as a family, but my little man clung to me. He was hearing the word virus. His daddy had had West Nile virus in 17. He's gone through some challenges. And he clung to me and began to cry out, I don't want my daddy to die. And I felt the Holy Ghost say, this is the moment that we go deeper in prayer. And for about 5 minutes, I coached my little boy. I talked to him. Just tell Jesus I love you, Jesus. Just tell Jesus I need you, Jesus. Just tell Jesus. And he actually, by the time we got to telling him the event was canceled the next night, he had said, Daddy, they're smart. They're smart. They're helping us be safe. And I was thankful for that. But for the first few minutes, I would say words and he would repeat, I'm hurting, Jesus. I need you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. And that after 5 minutes, I wasn't having to tell him any words to say. I wasn't having to tell him any words to say, sitting on the side of that king size bed, the prayer. I'll tell off on the girls after about 15 minutes. They got kind of sleepy. It was 11 o'clock at night. They eased on. Great prayer warriors that they were. They made it 20. Just messing. They're beautiful, precious, and they walk with the Lord. But it did last a good long time. He wasn't ready to quit. And then all of a sudden, in a moment so precious, he jumped up from the king-size bed. He ran into the bathroom. He turned on the water in the bathtub. I had just told that story Wednesday night, but I'm not piecing all this together. He's praying, Jesus, and he runs in the bathroom and pulls the stopper up and turns the water on and comes back in and praying. I said, what you doing, buddy? What you doing? He just kept on praying. And then another while, he went running back in there, and I heard him go, and I went in there, and that little man was standing in 3 inches of water with his hands raised to heaven, and Jesus was filling my little boy with the Holy Ghost. During the shutdown, God's not bound by social distancing rules. God brought an anointing into our home on a Friday night. God brought power into our home because God said, my Holy Ghost is going to help bring healing. My Holy Ghost is going to bring an anointing. My Holy Ghost. Would you just lift your hearts to the Lord for a moment right now? If there are tears flowing, I call them holy tears. Just let some holy tears flow right now. Let a ministry of the Spirit come into your pew right now. I walk these aisles right now. I speak to you from the front to the back. I said it earlier. You don't even have to be standing. You don't have to be raising your voice. You just slip your heart, slip your arms up to Jesus as a sign of surrender and a sign of worship. You may be the longest standing member of this church, or you may be a first time guest, but I speak that there is a hovering taking place over this atmosphere. There's a hovering of the Spirit. The Holy Ghost helicopter is hovering over this house. You can be renewed right where you stand. You can be ministered to, amen, the precious ushers and media team, the staff and the leaders. There's a ministry of the Holy Ghost in this atmosphere right now. When the waters are stirring, when the Spirit is stirring, when the waters are troubled, you step into that atmosphere. Ha. And that young man, that little boy that's sitting here on the third row, stayed standing in that 3 inches deep water in that bathtub praying for about 15 or 20 minutes. And then he started praying in English. And one of the lines, I'm going to say it as best as I remember it. Even if you're praying in a bathtub or if you're in a church somewhere, it don't matter. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. And I speak on this Sunday. I speak on this Sunday morning. There's a hovering in the atmosphere. Amen. Let's just do a Holy Ghost pause for a moment right now. Every eye closed, if you don't mind doing that for me. Would you slip both your hands to the heavens if you're comfortable? If you're a guest and you're not, no pressure. You talk to Jesus in your own way. But to me, lifting the hands is surrender and worship all at the same time. God, I'm asking you to come into every home. I'm asking you to come into every atmosphere. I don't have a tub of water up front. Amen. But as real as if there's a tub of water up front, somebody's going to step into the presence of the Lord right now. He's hovering over your family. He's hovering over your spirit. He's hovering over the atmosphere of your home. I speak anointing. If you need a refreshing, let that flow right now. Just do that. If you need a refreshing, let that flow right now. It may have been you may have struggled some during the last few months. That's okay. Amen. Jesus is not bound by social distancing. He comes into your pew right now. Let the Holy Ghost oil minister to you right now. Let the ministering of the Spirit come to you right now. Hallelujah. Yes, Jesus. There's healing coming to some homes right now. I'd like for you to put your hands back down, and if you don't mind opening your eyes for a minute. Those of you that have it's between you and Jesus, but you have a specific ministry from the Lord. I know we all can raise our hands, but you have something you need from Him in the Spirit. Maybe it's the Holy Ghost renewing or breakthrough in your mind, or your heart, or your family. I want you to just slip your hand. You don't have to identify what the need is, but would you just slip your hand up? We may come to the front in a moment, but I'm asking you, keep your hand up. Now I'm wanting the rest of you, just open your eyes. And if you're close, would you extend your hand? Maybe you feel, I'm not sure exactly how we're handling it with the social distancing, but if you feel to extend your hands, if you feel to maybe touch a hand on a shoulder, it's okay. The Holy Ghost is in this house right now. Now I want you to envision those that raise your hand. I want you to envision stepping into a tub of water. Stepping into a pool where that angel just stirred that current. Young lady, that's it. You're over here. Let the Holy Ghost just let Him do it right now. He's working in your life. Somebody let holy tears flow right now. Somebody pray in the Holy Ghost under your breath right now. Just let that flow. There are angels' wings brushing over this place. I believe if we could see the atmosphere, it'd be like a helicopter hovering over the waters. The Spirit is moving right now. I pray healing to your bodies, ministry to, that's it, young people, that's it, youth group, let that cry come out right now. That's it, young men, that's so powerful and beautiful, praying for a friend. Let anointing come in this house right now. Just pray for a moment right now. Just pray for a moment right now. There's oil in this house. I'm using this word a lot this morning, but his presence is just hovering over this atmosphere. Spirit is hovering over this atmosphere. Hallelujah. I believe this atmosphere calls for some more moments in his presence. So I'd like to invite all of us that will that come, but honor if someone wants or needs a few feet between each other. Just, we can do that with these aisles in the front, but could you just begin coming? Those that come first, come close, and then maybe those just behind can leave a spot. Hakeya Rabo Shataya. But that little 7-year-old with hurt in his heart heard his daddy tell a story about God healing his sister because she stepped in the water. And he went and stood in the bathtub and said, it don't matter if you're in a bathtub or if you're in a bathtub at home or if you're at church. Jesus loves you and he's defeating the devil. And his power is in your life. Well, today you're not standing in a bathtub, but you're standing in the spirit and the presence of the Lord. I'm moving softly on purpose because it's just a hovering. Just let that prayer flow. I see it on your faces. Just let it's okay. I'm not going to give big specific instructions right now because this is okay. Just let it hover. Just let it hover. Ministry staff and prayer team, if you see folks that are brand new or need guidance or assistance, amen. I'm trusting the ministry team and the prayer team to find those that may need some guidance. That's it, sir. Let that cry come right now. Just let those pure tears flow. Let those pure tears flow. He brings healing to your home. He brings healing to your family. He brings healing in relationships, in your marriage, in your family. I speak that in Jesus' name. He's hovering, and his word will work in your life in layers. Just let him work. That's it. Ministry team, take your liberty. You know your congregation. You know those that may be brand new and need some guidance, leaders of the church. Hallelujah. Prayer team, let that happen. If you see somebody near you, amen, that just needs a word of encouragement to break through, be that one that stands beside them. God, I worship you, Jesus. I worship you. Bless this young man. Bless this.
Lord, I feel you here. You're in the atmosphere. Your presence is here. I feel you. I'm desperate for you, Lord. I'm thirsty. I need more. I need your power. Oh, Lord,
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Spirit of the Lord is in this place right now. I wonder if we could lift our hands to Him right now. Just all across this room, just raise your hands to the Lord. The presence of God is in this place right now. Hallelujah. Just let Him begin to minister to you as an individual. Just you and the Lord right now. Just you and the Lord. Hallelujah. Congregation of one. Just you and the Lord. Talk to Him. I love you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Jesus, that's it. Just you and the Lord. Just you and the Lord. Yes, Lord Jesus. Everything just to you, Lord. To you. Hallelujah. Move on me, Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. It's God's will. It is God's will for us to be ministered to. In the first moment we see the creation, we see the Lord. His Spirit was moving upon the face of the water. The Lord told the prophet Isaiah, He said, I'm not going to look into temples made with hands, but into this man will I look, he that is lowly of heart and contrite in spirit. God is looking for people to let His active Spirit dwell in. Amen. Something about the sweet touch of the Holy Ghost that just ministers to every part of our life. It just has a way of reaching the areas of need, doesn't it? Amen. One person can receive healing. The other person receives encouragement. Somebody else receives a direction for their life. God's Spirit just moves, and it does a great work. Amen. Thank you so much, Brother Albritton, for that message today. I want to always respond to the moving of the Spirit of God. When God begins to move, you got to respond. Amen. Thank God for what He's doing here today. Amen. Sweet touch of the Holy Ghost. I believe that God has met with us, and we're going to continue on with revival tonight, 6 o'clock. 6 o'clock, we'll come early for prayer, and we will continue tonight. And remember, we are not going to have the choir tonight, but next Sunday, where I believe is the kickoff for the choir. Again, so thank God for that. Not the kickoff. I got to quit saying the choir's getting kicked off. The choir's getting restarted. How about that? So we've had to kick a few choir members off through the years, but that's a whole different story. Amen. But thank God for what He's doing. And I don't know. If I've got the microphone in my hand, I have no idea what I'm talking about. So, amen. But I'm so thankful for what He's doing here. I do want to mention, Before I dismiss you, I want to just take a moment and again mention, thank God for all of our evangelists. And Brother and Sister Groman are here with us today. They're evangelists basing out of our church. And out in the foyer, they have a display set up of their ministry. They have a great, very unique ministry. He goes everywhere teaching about creation science, and showing that the biblical account of Genesis is absolutely true. You can trust it. And so I encourage you, if you can, stop by the table, pick up some materials from them. I know it will be a blessing for them. But we are thankful for each of you that are here with us today. I'm asking Brother Curtis Harris to come, and he's going to pray a prayer of dismissal. And after he's finished praying, you can consider yourself dismissed in Jesus' name. And we're going to ask you to greet one another, please. You know, make sure it's all right and maintain some distance and all that stuff. But we love each of you. And we'll see you here tonight. Brother Harris.
What a beautiful message today. Aren't you thankful we serve a faithful God? Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we love you. We're so thankful today for your word that's gone forth. For every heart that's been touched today, we give you honor and glory in the name of Jesus. Thank you for what you've done, what we've seen, and what we can't see. We know that you've been working. We give you praise and glory in the beautiful name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Greet someone with a smile. Wave at them. Tell them you're glad to see them. You're dismissed. 5:30 prayer, 6 p.m. revival tonight.